this is Sue Painter with TravelChangesLife.com. I want to talk a little bit about selecting a cruise line and a cruise ship, especially in light of what has happened recently with the Viking cruise line ship, the Viking Sky. And this is not to bash Viking at all. I think they are a good cruise line, but I want to talk a little bit about how to pick cruise ships and cruise lines and why you need to think about things other than just the itinerary of where the ship is going. Viking has been a river cruise line primarily for many, many, many years, and they have been excellent at it. I have been on a Viking river cruise before, and I probably would go again. But lately, in the last several years, they decided to take to ocean cruising and expand what they offer from river cruising, which they still do, to ocean cruising. Ocean cruising is a whole different ball of wax from river cruising. So it's a whole new business line and a whole new way of doing business for Viking. They built several new ships, and the Viking Sky is one of those ships. It's only a couple of years old. I think it was actually launched in 2016, but didn't go into service with Viking until 2017. At the time, I'm not sure who the captain is currently. I actually couldn't find that on the internet, but I know when it first began, the Viking Sky was given a captain who had many, many years of experience in the maritime industry, not all of them as a captain of a ship, because of course people come up into the ranks. He had previously worked, I think, with Norwegian and probably other cruise lines as well. So if he is the captain of the ship when the ship currently got into its problem up in the up outside of Norway, then I don't know, but there he is an experienced maritime person. But really, it's more than that. Viking did a wonderful marketing job, brilliant actually. They were very genius to become an advertiser during the days on PBS of Downton Abbey, and they became a well-known brand and a household name as a result of that marketing campaign. They certainly are not the only river ship, and they certainly are not the only ocean-going ship, but they advertise in a brilliant way. And when Downton Abbey quit being produced, new episodes being produced, then Viking moved over and started advertising also on PBS with Victoria, I believe it was. I think when we were watching Victoria, I saw their ads. I have been hesitant to recommend Viking as an ocean cruise ship. There are some things I like about it. I like that it is small, because smaller ships always give you a better experience than bigger ships, unless you are going for the experience of the ship and you're into the shows and the dancing and the nightlife. You care about that more than you care about the destination of where you're going. So for that reason, I have been interested and curious about the Viking cruise ships. However, they're new to the ocean, and as I said before, the ocean is a different beast than river cruising. So my take on it has been not to really recommend it to the people who come to me for travel advice or to book their travel, but to wait a couple of years and just see how things settle in for them on the ocean. I'm not saying I never would have used a Viking cruise ship. I probably would have in time, and I probably would still go on one myself. But it's just a matter of having that experience and kind of seeing how they do on the ocean, and if they do as well, safety-wise, as they have certainly done in river cruising. There were 915 passengers on this ship, I think, and it holds 458 crew. I think when that ship is full, it can hold 930 passengers, so it wasn't quite full when this emergency happened, but it was almost full. And what happened, as far as I can tell from reading the maritime reports, which you're going to give you a great look at what's really going on versus, you know, the news things, which are going to always try to make it overly dramatic, although it certainly has been dramatic, is that it experienced an engine failure. So this puts me in mind of a couple of things. Ships go out of their way to keep their passengers safe and to keep the ship safe, because these ships are so horribly expensive and take so long to build. This ship was built by Fincantieri, who builds almost all of the cruise ships in the world these days. It's certainly, it had all the modern technology and a modern hull and modern engines. It had both gas engines and electric engines. So for it to suffer a complete engine failure is a big deal, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of investigations ongoing about what in the systems caused something to happen like that. But my thoughts go in this direction, because I'm always thinking about passengers and the passenger experience, because that's what I specialize in, is making sure that there's a good match between the passengers and the places or the ships that I recommend they go on, or the places that I recommend they travel to. First of all, most ships, when there is harsh weather, will take the ship out of harm's way, and of course the passengers out of harm's way, by amending the itinerary. And I think in this case, the weather can turn very quickly in those waters. I think they actually were supposed to make a stop that they decided not to make, and they were trying to come further and get out of the wind and the gale force winds. But it makes me wonder, kind of in a way, why they were up there anyway. I know their claim to fame is they're small and they can go into different ports, and that's a good thing. That's a really good thing to have that capability in a ship. But I do think about, should the ship have come out of the weather faster? If they could have, that might not have even been possible. I don't know. I also think about maintenance. Maintenance on the ship is a heavy-duty, ongoing thing. Most of the time, if you've ever been on a cruise ship, I know we have been on many ships, and we see them doing maintenance exercises and maintenance runs all the time. And it's because ships are out in this really hostile environment of the ocean, and they have to be maintained and to keep their engines running so that they don't get into any kind of a bad situation. So I'm sure there'll be a big investigation about why they lost engine all at once. And eventually what happened is, you know, they got some of their engines running, so with the help of some assist vessels and I think maybe one tug, they are now being tugged into port. They did take not quite half, I think 400 or so passengers off by helicopter in high winds. That was very unpleasant, I'm sure, and risky for both the emergency crews and for the passengers. And I really hate to hear that that had to go on, because that had to have been scary and really uncomfortable. I certainly, if it had been me, I wouldn't have liked it at all. But kudos to the Norwegian emergency services people who managed to get there in very high winds. They could not launch the lifeboats because of they were afraid that the winds would not make the emergency lifeboats stable, and they might get thrown up against the rocks. They were worried about losing the ship on the rocks to begin with. So now they are going into an emergency port with I think half or maybe a little more than half of the passengers and all the crew still on board. So it's, you know, the worst of it is over for sure. But you really want to think about, you know, who's the captain? What is the captain's experience? How long has this cruise line been sailing in those particular waters? Not just anywhere in the world, but in those particular waters. What is their record in the news of maintenance? Do they have a lot of maintenance issues? This is almost a brand new ship. 2 years old is no time at all in ship age. So it really makes me wonder what in the world happened to all those engines. And who the captain is and what the experience is. The other thing that this really brings to bear is the importance of safety musters. And it is international law that before a ship leaves port, when it is beginning a cruise, every single person on the ship, every passenger, every crew has to participate in an emergency muster. And Viking, of course, did that before they left shore. So, you know, you had been told, these passengers had been told what they were supposed to do if the ship sounded its emergency alarm. And of course they had speaker systems and all of that to also alert passengers what to do. But I have a lot of people who go cruising and they kind of whine about having to do that emergency muster. Believe me, you want to do that. You want to pay attention to what you are supposed to do and where you are supposed to go if the ship has an alarm, because it could be your life on the line, and you want to make it as easy and as safe as possible for the crew who has to stay on board to help you as well. So this isn't a big thing about Viking at all. I'm sure they will be very curious and very go after it hard to see what happened and make sure that those kind of things don't happen again. I'm not saying I would never travel them. I'm not saying you should never travel them. I'm not saying you should never take a cruise. All travel is risky. Staying at home is risky too. I'm just saying that if you would ask me, I probably would have said, let's wait a year or two before we do Viking ocean cruises. Viking river cruises, they have a long, long history of being on the rivers in Europe, and a very safe record of being on the rivers in Europe as well. So I am wishing all the passengers and the crew of the Viking Sky the best. I hope that everyone gets home safely. Those people who were injured heal well. And when you are thinking about a cruise line, if you just take those things into consideration, and if you want to contact me for travel advice, you can reach me at travelchangeslife@gmail.com. This is Sue Painter with travelchangeslife.com. Happy traveling. Bye-bye.